Southeast Asia now, where there's still no end in sight for protesters in Thailand. This despite a red shirt leader's proposal for a ceasefire. Dozens are dead and hundreds more injured as red shirts continue to fight off soldiers and military snipers in Bangkok, where they are protesting. Now, red shirt leaders are asking for UN-mediated talks, yet the Thai government says no discussions will take place until demonstrators leave the area. Meanwhile, the so-called military strategist of the red shirts died today after an alleged sniper shot him. So what's behind the fray? Are we seeing a social revolution in the region? And is it closer than meets the eye to the unrest we're seeing in Europe? In Spain, for example, where civil servants are threatening to strike the government blows to their livelihood. Well, joining me now to give us his take on what's behind these uprisings we're seeing is Andrew Gavin Marshall. He's a research associate from the Center for Research on Globalization. Thank you for joining us. I actually want to start by backing up a little bit to Greece. That's where we saw, you know, 100,000 protesters hit the streets a few weeks ago now over the austerity measures. And now over the weekend, we had the Prime Minister of Greece saying he wants to investigate investment banks and their role in the Greek debt crisis. Is Greece looking to deflect blame here? Are the investment banks responsible for their sovereign debt crisis?
Well, ultimately, everyone is responsible in a position of power. The previous Greek governments have been responsible for their bad policies and their collusion with the investment banks. It's not about one or the other. It's central banks, investment banks, and government power. And together, they've all accumulated this bad debt, and now they're all being required to implement fiscal austerity measures, which is a great euphemism for social dismantling. And so naturally what happens is that riots arise, rebellion occurs, and this isn't simply about Greece or Ireland or even Iceland. This is about the collapse of Western civilization and about the elimination of the middle classes of the West. And so as sure enough as a debt crisis will spread across the West, governments of the West will be forced to implement fiscal austerity measures. Which in effect dismantle the social society. And so naturally people will riot and rebel. Even Moody's, a top credit rating agency, in March said that there will be riots across the West, from Germany to the UK to all the way to America. So this isn't simply a Greek problem or an Icelandic issue or even an Irish issue. Even yesterday in Spain we saw massive protests against the austerity measures. So this is a crisis of Western civilization.
I want to ask you about that, because we're talking about a crisis of Western civilization. You mentioned a disappearance of the middle class. Now, yeah. The divide between the rich and poor is also something that seems to be behind the protests we're seeing in Thailand. Can you tie this to more than a Western crisis of civilization? Are we seeing social revolution going on, you know, on a larger scale?
Absolutely. In February of 2009, Dennis Blair, the Director of National Intelligence, who oversees all 16 U.S. intelligence agencies, told the Senate Intelligence Committee that the greatest threat to national security is the economic crisis. And he was referring to the regime-threatening instability that can be caused by economic crises. So he's implying that not only is it a domestic issue in terms of the potential for social unrest, but it's also an international issue. So the response of governments, particularly the United States, would be to militarize both foreign and domestic policy. So you have something like Africa Command, or AFRICOM as it is known, which was created in October of 2007 and essentially militarizes foreign policy in Africa. So you have this need to control the remaining resources of the world. So in an economic decline, you see imperial mobilization. As empires decline, as the U.S. empire is declining, you see rapid, increased international violence and war. You see the expansion of the war in Pakistan. You see the expansion of conflict in Africa. The expansion of military presence in South America. So you see this militarization abroad, but also the homeland security state at home, which is more about controlling the people than protecting the people. And it's it's a very global issue. So you'll have people rising up in rebellion everywhere. In 2007, the British Ministry of Defense released a trend report looking over the next several decades for global trends. In it, they stated that the middle classes of the world will become revolutionary and take on the role of the proletariat as envisaged by Marx. So you have an acknowledgement by the military, by the national security apparatus, that the middle classes will become revolutionary, and this will be as a result of increased social dislocation, of increased wealth disparities, and as the middle class is pushed down into poverty and into the labor class.
And we'll have to see how this all plays out, but we certainly appreciate all of that insight.